Thank Jamie for organizing my visit. She's running me ragged from 8 yesterday morning to 1 last night, and again at 8 this morning, and who knows how long we'll stay up tonight, but anyhow, I've really had a good time visiting with people here. Okay, so to get started here, so really one of the challenges for ecologists is that we're often asked to think about how issues like global change are going to affect broad landscapes. So here's a nice image of Alaska. And one of the things that pops off the page at you is what's shaded here is the topography across the region. And one of the things we'd like to do is to be able to generalize about how ecological processes play out over broad spatial scales, even though as ecologists we're typically forced, due to logistical reasons, to study things at really local scales. And really the gist of what I'm going to talk about today is to talk about how topography of watersheds actually gives us a lot of power to extrapolate from individual sites or small spatial scales where we can actually measure things to landscape scales that are relevant to things like asking about how global change is going to affect how, for instance, this landscape sequesters or releases carbon to the atmosphere. And one of the reasons that's interesting in Alaska, this is just a map of where soils, where the carbon is in soils globally, but in green here, of course, is the boreal region, and this transition between boreal and Arctic is where a lot of the world's carbon is stored in soils, and there's been a lot of emphasis in the ecological literature asking how the fate of this carbon is going to change as the world warms up. And most of that interest has really been asking, well, how much more greenhouse gases are going to come out of soils because of increased respiration that's going to produce CO2 and methane? And what hasn't been asked as much is alternative fates of that carbon, particularly how they're used in aquatic systems. So you get organic matter that's in the terrestrial component of landscapes. It'll trickle downhill, be transported by aquatic systems. Some of it will be remineralized and released to the atmosphere there, but some of it will be used in situ. And that will be controlled by temperature as well. So the landscapes that I'm working in are ones I talked about yesterday. So this is Bristol Bay. And in particular, I'm going to look at this landscape right here, which has, for convenience purposes, it has remarkable geomorphic diversity across relatively small spatial scales. So I'm going to talk about work in the Wood River system, which is a pretty short river. It's on the order of about 120 kilometers long. It's really dominated by a few major lakes. But even within that relatively small watershed, the western side is really steep and looks like this, big ragged mountains. And then it transitions to this really flat coastal plain to the east. And it turns out, it turns out, as I'll show you in a second, that the hydrology and the amount of carbon that's sitting on the landscape is very different in watersheds that look like this compared to watersheds that look like this. So from a scientific standpoint, it's really convenient to go in and ask, are there differences in terms of how aquatic ecosystems transport and transform carbon depending on whether the stream is draining a watershed that looks like that versus that? So the three little stories I'm going to tell you today are these. The first two are really about carbon processing, and the first is just to ask, along a geomorphic gradient in watershed conditions, is there a difference in terms of the dominant organic matter sources that support benthic invertebrates and streams? The second part of it is really thinking about, well, what's going to happen to these dominant metabolic processes in streams if these streams warm up with ongoing global change? So what we're going to do, or what I'll do, is highlight some work we've been doing assessing how sensitive ecosystem metabolism is to temperature. And then the last little story I'll talk about is how wide-ranging predators, whether they're bears, trout, or birds, actually exploit the complexity across the broader landscape in ways that give us interesting insights in terms of how to conserve these functioning landscapes. So I'll start with the first one, which is about the sources of organic matter that support invertebrates in streams. And really it boils down to this, is that the watersheds have this distinct gradient gradient in terms of geomorphic conditions. And it turns out the geomorphic conditions can be characterized through a bunch of different variables. And most of those variables are very collinear. So just the principal components analysis here, you can estimate from watersheds like this what their slope is, what their average elevation is, how much lake area contributes, what's the substrate size of the gravel in streams. All of these things are really correlated. And it turns out that watershed's average slope alone is kind of a master variable that captures a lot of the geomorphic variation among streams. Okay, so I'm going to talk mostly about watershed's average watershed slope here because it captures all these other things. Watersheds that are steep have big gravel in them. Watersheds that are shallow have very fine gravel in them. Steep watersheds also happen to be higher elevation, etc. And just to convince you that the chemistry of these streams varies in accordance with geomorphic conditions, here's just a principal components analysis on stream chemistry for a bunch of streams. And it turns out that DOC, carbon to nitrogen ratio, total nitrogen, N-to-P ratio of the nutrients, all of these things are really tightly constrained by geomorphic conditions. Flat watersheds tend to have a lot of DOC in them. This is coming out of wetlands. Steeper watersheds don't have a lot of wetlands. The water's really clear. They don't transport a lot of carbon in them. Similarly, the steep watersheds have a lot of alder in the watersheds, and the streams are very nitrogen rich. Flat watersheds are dominated by wetlands, and they're very nitrogen poor. And here's, for instance, the example of DOC. Water that looks brown, this is someone else's photo, but water that's brown has a lot of DOC in it, and this is coming off of flat watersheds. Steep watersheds down here have very little DOC, and they look crystal clear. So just to give you an indication that slope alone determines how much organic carbon is actually stored in the landscape, if we compare these two types of watersheds, steep and shallow, you know, this is what the accumulation of organic matter looks like in the soils. Here's a steep watershed. The organic matter is really centimeters thick in these watersheds. And as the gradient goes up, you accumulate less and less organic matter. Flat watersheds accumulate enormous amounts of peat. So if you take a profile here of the peat, you know, the stuff down here was laid down 3,000 or 4,000 years ago. And it basically has accumulated because it's not being transported off the watershed and it's not decomposing very rapidly. But that stuff is slowly leaking out into the aquatic systems and affects their chemistry. So I'll talk a little bit about some work that Adrienne Smits did for part of her dissertation. And she just asked a very simple question. Within the same river basin, if you take streams of exactly the same size, same stream order, and all you do is tilt them up at different levels across the river basin, do they have different sources of carbon that support the consumers? And does that give you a way to think about how climate change and changing land use may alter the dominant organic matter sources in those streams? And really what she's doing here is testing the dominance of these pathways. So this is what I'll call the traditional pathway, thinking about how primary production moves into consumers, and that's simply by primary production taking up carbon dioxide and passing it up to herbivores. People working in aquatic systems for a couple decades now have appreciated that the heterotrophic food chain is equally or more important in many cases, where you have terrestrial organic matter coming in, either in dissolved or particulate form. Aquatic bacteria are consuming that organic matter, and then these become the sources of energy for higher level consumers. So we can use fatty acids, it turns out, to ask for some dominant grazers or dominant consumers, in this case caddisflies and mayflies, is there a systematic change in the importance of algal sources versus heterotrophic sources in supporting the food web? So this is just a PCA of all the fatty acids out of a bunch of bugs. The open triangles are mayflies, caddisflies are the filled ones. And what you see, first of all, is that across all these streams, the two taxa, even though they're in the same stream, collected in the same samples, are really partitioning resources quite distinctly. Okay, and then superimposed on this are the vectors pointing to the dominant indicator fatty acids. So diatoms are down here, for instance, and the caddisflies tend to map onto diatom algal sources, whereas the bacterial fatty acids, so fatty acids that are branched and distinctive for heterotrophic organisms tend to be more associated with mayflies. So the question is, is there a geomorphic pattern in this as well? And the simple answer is, yeah. Let's just look at a couple of these panels. Again, here we have a watershed slope for, I don't know what this is, 15 streams or so. And if we look at algal fatty acids for the caddisflies, what we see is that as you move to steeper and steeper watersheds, algae become a more dominant component of the resource base that supports caddisflies. So steeper streams, more algae. And if we look at heterotrophic bacteria, what's being traded off here is the bacteria become less important as the pitch of the watershed increases. Okay, so that bacteria are really most important in the shallowest watersheds, as you'd expect, because this is where most of the organic matter is coming in from the terrestrial landscape. It turns out that the story is a little more complicated because there's really there's multiple pathways through which heterotrophic production can make it into bacteria and then to consumers. There's anaerobic and there's aerobic. And in the case of the anaerobic pathways, there's been a lot of interest in the last 10 years or so at looking at methane oxidizing bacteria. So a lot of these landscapes are producing, are remineralizing organic carbon via anaerobic metabolism, which is producing methane, and then there's bacteria that oxidize that methane, and then those bacteria make it up into consumers. So the question is, does methane oxidation and the algae, and the bacteria that it supports also vary across the landscape? And you know, there's reasons to believe if you go to places, there's certain little seeps and whatnot that are clearly anaerobic, that are full of methane. And the question is, do those sources make it into the food web as well? And here the results are very clear cut. For both caddisflies and mayflies, methane oxidizers can be very important in consumers. So consumers are not producing these fatty acids, they're assimilating them from the bacteria they're consuming. They're prevalent only in watersheds that are less than about 8 degree pitch on average. You get to the steeper watersheds and there's no methane oxidizers there. Similarly, for sulfate reducers, these are the things that make swamp gas or H2S through sulfate reduction. Again, these are most important in flat watersheds and become increasingly less important at steeper watersheds. So same streams, same biogeographic provinces, and all we're doing is changing the slope of these watersheds, and you get a fundamentally different metabolic base to the food webs in these streams. So that when we look across this landscape, you can actually make some pretty good judgments about what the dominant trophic pathways are in individual streams. That simply depends on some really basic geomorphic characteristics that you can get through GIS, for instance, off a map such as this. Okay, so that's sort of story one. And really, I think I just said this, is that what we see is that geomorphology controls the base of the food web, okay? And it's simply due to the importance of terrestrial organic matter that's accumulated in watersheds, depending on what their slope is. The second really question is whether geomorphology controls the metabolic rates of the dominant metabolic processes in these streams, particularly in terms of their response to temperature. And this becomes important when we think about, well, what's the fate of these ecosystems when we move into a warmer future? They're going to warm up. Presumably, the metabolic activities will crank up a little more. And the question is, where's that carbon going to go? Is it going to blow off to the atmosphere? Will it be processed differently in the streams, et cetera? And are there geomorphic reasons why they would speed up more in some streams and not in others? So the one of the things that, again, aquatic ecologists have realized in the last few decades is that the old model that assumed that rivers, for instance, were basically just conduits of terrestrial matter out to the ocean, so they were assumed to be closed pipes. It turns out that people have begun to realize that the rivers in particular, as that organic matter is transported via rivers to the ocean, there's actually a lot of metabolic activity and transformation that occurs as the material is transported downhill. So that some of it's taken up in primary production, some of it's off-gassed CO2, et cetera. So I'll talk about some work that Kathy Jo Jankowski did for her dissertation, which is to ask the question of whether there is geomorphic controls on the relative contributions of several of these processes as organic matter is transferred downstream. And then what's the sensitivity of these processes to water temperature? And really what we're doing here is looking at how aquatic respiration, and this is respiration of the aggregate community, responds to temperature, but also to the quality of the carbon that is transported by the stream. So what I just showed you from the bug example is that steep streams tend to transport a relatively higher fraction of algal carbon, whereas flat streams tend to transport a relatively higher fraction of terrestrial-derived carbon, organic material. So each of these is contribute to aquatic respiration. The relative contributions of these things is going to depend on watershed slope. So the question is, why would that affect the sensitivity of metabolism to temperature? And I refer to this as the Brussels sprouts hypothesis. And what we're looking at here is just some expectations for how aquatic respiration rate at the ecosystem level is going to change to temperature. And the idea here is that if you have high quality carbon, okay, the bacteria will always be able to access that carbon and break it down. And as a result, there's not much sensitivity in the respiration rate to the temperature. Okay, so this is like eating arugula or something. Arugula is so tasty when it's nice and fresh. You don't need to cook it. It's palatable. It's nutritious and all the rest. And then you go to Brussels sprouts. Brussels sprouts, these woody, nasty things that you don't want to eat. You can probably can't digest unless you cook them, right? So this is where you have low quality organic carbon, where at low temperatures, you know, the metabolic rates of the bacteria are just not, they're not high enough to crack into that low quality carbon. And only by warming up the low quality carbon do the microbes gain access to it and can start metabolizing it. Okay? So the basic hypothesis is that in systems that have a lot of high quality organic compounds, namely those with low carbon to nitrogen ratios, that the systems should be relatively insensitive to water temperature. Whereas you go to systems like those flat ones that are transporting lots of terrestrial derived carbon that has sat out there in the landscape for hundreds, if not thousands of years, and all that's left is the recalcitrant stuff. If that's what the organic, if that's the main component of the organic matter being transported, then that stuff's like Brussels sprouts, and a little bit of warming can actually have a big effect on the ability of microbes to break it down. So low quality systems with high C to N ratios should be very sensitive to temperature, and high quality systems with low carbon to nitrogen ratios should be relatively insensitive to temperature, because it's always good stuff. The microbes can always get onto it. Okay, so how do we do this? We didn't measure breakdown of the carbon. We look at the inverse, which is, if you remember this from basic biology, is that photosynthesis is taking CO2 and producing oxygen. Respiration is taking oxygen and oxidizing organic compounds and making CO2. Turns out it's really easy to measure oxygen dynamics in streams, so we infer the metabolic rates by looking at the dynamics of oxygen in these systems. And Odom pointed this out in the 50s, that if you measure the oxygen concentration in an aquatic system through time, you often get these big cycles in, for instance, percent saturation. He didn't have beautiful data like this because he didn't have electronic probes back then. He was doing Winkler titration, so he got snapshots. But now oxygen probes are very sensitive and relatively cheap, and you can generate data like this very easily. And from this, you can infer the metabolic rates of the ecosystem. So here's Kathy Jo, and she did two approaches to test this hypothesis that geomorphology controls organic matter sources to streams. The organic matter composition of streams affects the sensitivity of their metabolic rates to changes in temperature. So she did it through sort of a microcosm approach by taking sediments out of different streams, incubating them at different temperatures, and asking how does it ramp up with changes in incubation temperature. And another one where we do some in situ estimates and some modeling to estimate what the temperature sensitivity rates are. So here's the Wood River watershed. Here's a bunch of sites that she sampled across this geomorphic gradient. And this is the question we're asking. And the way we estimate temperature sensitivity is through this Arrhenius equation. There's a big literature on this. in the metabolic theory of ecology, if you guys have followed that, Jim Brown and crowd. But basically what you do is you transform your temperature, and this coefficient here, E, is the activation energy, which describes this relationship between a transformed estimate or measurement of temperature and the measured respiration rate. So the steeper the slope, the more temperature-sensitive metabolism is to temperature. So here's the data from this microcosm approach, where she took a whole bunch of streams, took sediments from them, incubated the sediments at different temperatures, and asked what's the rate at which they consume oxygen. And there's the data. It's all pretty messy. In general, all the slopes are positive, so respiration rate is higher at warmer temperatures. The reason you do the Arrhenius equation is to linearize this. So not surprisingly, as you warm things up, they consume more oxygen. That's not what's shocking. What is interesting is the slopes of these lines. So the slopes of these lines are shown in the other panels. So here is the DOC concentration in the stream, and here's how sensitive the respiration rate is to changes in temperature. And sure enough, sites with lots of DOC are very temperature sensitive. Sites with little DOC are not very temperature sensitive. If you look at the quality of the carbon, where you have the C to N ratio, sites that have really poor quality carbon are very sensitive to temperature. Sites that have high quality carbon or low C to N ratios are not very temperature sensitive. And here's our master geomorphic variable, which is slope. And as things get steeper, they generally tend to get less sensitive to temperature changes in the environment. So this is a microcosm approach done in buckets that seems to support this hypothesis that geomorphology controls how sensitive metabolism to changes in temperature. But it's only a bucket experiment. There's so many reasons why this is bogus, right? So we also did it at the ecosystem scale and measured these things at the ecosystem scale. So here's a typical stream that we're trying to measure the metabolic properties of. And the way we can do this is just put an oxygen probe in it and just monitor oxygen every 10 minutes for a few days. And what's going on there is that you'll get these swings in oxygen. This is a percent saturation. So during the day, it'll ramp up in saturation. During the night, it'll draw down. And this signal has a lot of biological information in it. And in essence, what's going on is if we overlay the light intensity, what you have is a biological system that's continuously chasing the physical signal produced by changing light. Because photosynthesis, of course, is cranking up as the lights come on. Respiration is always going on. And then on top of that, we have diurnal changes in temperature. So the light is both causing the photosynthesis system to kick in and produce oxygen, but the light is also warming up the water and therefore modifying respiration rates at the same time. So from these types of data, we can estimate what the temperature sensitivity of the system is. And the way we do that is to develop a process model of oxygen dynamics, mainly modeling photosynthesis and respiration. We fit the model to observations and then basically do what ecosystem ecologists call inverse modeling, okay, which is really trying to infer the processes from the observations. Now, this is what fishery scientists do. They don't have any idea what the processes are, but they try to infer what they are based on, for instance, how many fish are out there. Your typical ecosystem scientist goes and measures the processes and tries to infer what the system's going to do as a result of it. So this is a somewhat novel approach where we can estimate very difficult to measure parameters, such as the rate at which the stream equilibrates with the atmosphere, which is a really key parameter in these types of models that's really hard to measure in situ. But here, the oxygen actually tells us what that rate can be. And then one of the parameters we're estimating in this model is this E, which is the sensitivity of the respiration in this ecosystem to changes in temperature. So we can do this. So there's that Arrhenius equation. Just to impress upon you that E is actually a parameter that we can measure. This is just a simulation where we've held everything constant in our model. And all we've done is vary E, that temperature sensitivity, a little bit. And depending on what the value of E is, you can see that the swing in oxygen takes on a very different shape depending on how sensitive the ecosystem is to changes in temperature. So the question is, can we pull that out of diurnal observed changes in the system? So these are just four examples that show contrasts in how the oxygen swings through time I guess the black is observations and the red is the model fits. And you can see this model has enough parameters in it that we can actually get a pretty good fit to the data in all sorts of different circumstances. The question is that E parameter, the parameter that modifies how quickly organic matter is broken down through respiration, is that parameter estimatable? So we do this in a Bayesian context so that we can get a posterior distribution of the parameter out of the model. And these are what's called the posterior distributions of the estimate of this temperature sensitivity. I'm just showing you 9 examples here, but all of these things are very estimatable. So some of these are close to zero, but most of these are falling in the range that we observed in the bucket experiments. And it turns out they occupy a pretty constrained range of each of these parameters depending on what site you're looking at. So interesting, you have a pretty simple biological system in terms of oxygen production and consumption. You fit a relatively simple biological model to it, and you can actually pull out the temperature sensitivity from it. So what does it look like if we return to our geomorphic hypothesis? So here we're just plotting it versus the carbon to nitrogen ratio in the water. So again, this is poor quality stuff, low quality. Here's high quality stuff. And here's what the temperature sensitivity measured at the scale of the ecosystem is. So when Kathy Jo did this, I was like blown away. And she's like, oh, it's a crappy R squared. It's only 0.36. And then I pointed out to her, just think what you just did. You know, you just measured oxygen and temperature in these streams for a couple days. And you can estimate how sensitive the fundamental metabolic processes of these streams are to changes in temperature. And it's in the direction that we expect based on this carbon quality hypothesis. That was 4 different years of data. You break it down by year. Here I'm plotting it versus the log of slope. And in all cases, the relationship's in the right direction. Steeper watersheds have less temperature sensitivity. Flat watersheds that have a lot of recalcitrant organic carbon being transported by them have higher temperature sensitivities. We do get differences among years. We're not really sure what this is. We think it's because of hydrologic differences from year to year, such that in years where the system is transporting more carbon, you get different dynamics than in drought years where it's transporting less carbon. But we really haven't come up with a good explanation for why it varies so much from year to year. But the point is that within a year, the steep watersheds simply are not temperature sensitive. And we think it's because they have all this high quality algal-derived carbon in there. The microbes can always get into that stuff. It's in those flat watersheds where you have this accumulation of carbon over millennia where temperature changes mean a lot. So if we then compare among what we estimated in the buckets, this is just a box plot of all the different estimates. You know, the average here is about 0.7. The ecosystem estimates where we measure these in situ are more variable but actually depressed. And we think some of this has to do with the fact that a lot of the water is actually flowing hyporheically, and the hyporheic metabolic machinery is not experiencing the variation in temperature that you measure at the surface of the stream. So we think some of this dampening is due to hydrologic processes. And then interestingly, if you compare it to what the metabolic theory of ecology suggests, you know, they say that basically all aquatic metabolic processes should have a temperature sensitivity of about 0.7. And their argument, or it's like 0.67, and their argument is that it's the same basic enzymes that are causing these metabolic, are the guts of the metabolic machinery in aquatic ecosystems. So therefore, they argue that the expectation would be that all ecosystems have the same temperature sensitivity. You know, what we think is a weakness of that argument is that it's not just the enzymes that determine the metabolic rates, it's also the substrates that they're working on. Are there any soil scientists here? I've been meeting with lots of soil scientists the last couple days, but there's a bunch of literature in the soil science journals that shows that, sure enough, the quality of litter depends really, has a huge control on the rate at which the enzymatic processes can get into that stuff and break it down. And it seems like we're seeing the same thing in aquatic systems. And ultimately, what controls this at the landscape scale is simply the topography. The geomorphic conditions over which water's flowing, over which organic matter is accumulating and then transported into the aquatic system. Okay, so that's the first two stories. The last one is thinking a little bit about how the landscape operates instead of for little microbes, but for larger, more mobile predators, and asking, are there features again in watershed conditions such as slope that affect how things like bears and birds and trout operate when they integrate across the whole landscape? There's a picture of one of the watersheds in winter. Obviously, it's a very snowy place, and a stream like this, of course, is going to have a lot of snow melt in it during the following summer. This is work by Peter Lisi, and what he showed, again, looking across this geomorphic gradient, steep in the west, flat on the east, is that you can use the isotopes of oxygen and hydrogen to determine how much of the summer stream flow is derived from either rainfall or from melt of snow that accumulated the previous winter. And the little pies here to show you how much is rain versus snow. And in general, not surprisingly, streams on the west side that have a lot of topography have more snow melt in them because those mountains are capturing wintertime precip as snow, whereas the flatter watersheds on the east side have less snow melt because they're flatter and precip is more likely to fall as rainfall. And then, so here we have our geomorphic gradient. This is simply, in this case, two principal components, steep watersheds, flat watersheds, and this is the proportion of rain in them. As you get to flatter watersheds, the contribution of rain to summer flow goes up. And then superimposed on this is the average stream temperature. So flat watersheds tend to be a lot warmer than steep watersheds, and that's strongly correlated with the contributions of snowmelt to summertime flows. And one of the mechanisms here is that when you get warm air temperatures, it melts more snow. Snowmelt keeps these relatively small streams. These are second to fourth order streams, cool despite warm air temperatures. So why does this matter to birds and fish and bears? The reason it matters is as I talked about yesterday, is these watersheds support these really spectacular concentrations of salmon that are coming back from the ocean. They're genetically distinct, coming back to individual tributaries to spawn. And it turns out that if you look at the water temperatures across the watershed, you can see this big gradient from 4 or 5 degrees to 13, 14, 15 degrees Celsius, all within, you know, tens of kilometers of one another. So these are traces of summertime temperatures of a bunch of streams within this watershed. And it turns out that the date at which the salmon spawn is pretty strongly correlated with the summertime stream temperature. In cold streams, fish tend to spawn earlier because it takes longer for those embryos to develop to the point they can wriggle down to the gravel and overwinter. In warm streams, the fish spawn later in the season, like in 1st of September, because there the water temperature is warmer, the embryos develop faster, and then they don't have to be in the gravel as long. The other thing that we think is going on is that in the warm streams in the middle of summer, those things can get up to 20 degrees, even though this is pretty high latitude system. And at those high temperatures, the spawning adults are actually prone to temperature-induced diseases. Anyhow, the point is across this landscape, you have thermal variation. That's again a function of watershed slope. You have local adaptation of the salmon onto those different streams. And as a result, you have pretty big variation in when the salmon spawn at different points in the watershed. So why does that matter to predators? Well, it turns out that whether it's a bear or a char or a trout, when the salmon are spawning, these predators are literally binging on salmon resources. They're easy to capture. They're really high nutrient and lipid content. And literally, these predators are packed to the rim, to the gills, whenever the salmon are available. And they're only available when they're actively spawning. If they're not spawning, they're holding in deep water and the predators can't get to them. It's only when they move into streams, into shallow water, start doing their thing, that eggs become available to fish, and the salmon become available to things like bears. So why would time be a limiting resource? Okay, the metaphor I use here is that I don't know what the main street is here, but if you're a grad student and you want to exploit the all-you-can-eat buffets at the restaurants in town, if all the restaurants have an all-you-can-eat buffet on the same day of the week, know, you can probably go pig out once a week and you're not going to get particularly healthy, you know. But if every restaurant has an all-you-can-eat buffet on different days of the week, you're going to be pigging out for 7 days of the week, and you're going to have to do a lot more skiing to stay fit. So in the case of the consumers, if all the salmon came in and spawned at exactly the same time, the predators would only have about 2 or 3 weeks to binge on salmon. But what we've seen here is that we have this gradient in geomorphology, which produces a gradient in hydrology and thermal regime, and therefore an extension of when fish are spawning across the watershed. And we see lots of evidence that time is a limiting resource for predators. So this is a typical dead salmon that we see looks like this, okay? Most of the fish is not eaten. That's a fish that's had a bear take a chomp out of it. Here's one that hasn't been eaten at all. The flies are getting on it. Here's the remnants of a bunch of carcasses that bears have eaten. They've probably taken less than 5% out of the salmon, and they throw the rest away. So a quick little video, I think this will work. Okay, so this is so brown bears, big nasty predators, you know, shred things up and eat everything. So here's a brown bear that's captured a salmon. Ah, darn it. Maybe it's not going to work. Okay, so there's caught a salmon, takes a little nibble out of its brain, and it walks away. What's the problem with that predator, right? It should gulp down that whole salmon. Well, what it's doing is it's probably just high grading for the most nutritious little nibble out of that salmon. It turns out the brain is a really fatty tissue, particularly in male salmon. The female salmons, they usually eat the eggs, but in males, they'll take a little snack out of the brain and they throw the rest of the fish away. And it's probably because they're limited by how much fish they can carry around in their bellies and digest. So they high grade for the most nutritious stuff, which is a pretty good indication that they're not limited by the abundance of salmon. They're limited by time to eat and digest that food. So now, if we look across the watershed, this is when fish spawn at a bunch of different sites, and it shows that if the consumers, whether they're bears, trout, birds, can move with this wave of salmon as it propagates across the landscape, they can start feeding on salmon in the middle of July, and then if they can move with the fish, they can move across the landscape, and they can still be eating salmon into October. If all the fish spawned at the same time, they would probably have about 3 weeks to feed on salmon. Or if they can't move and they're stuck in one site, then they could probably only eat salmon for about 3 weeks. So the question is, do they move? So we did a real simple study. We just put a bunch of trail cameras up on streams and just let them take pictures of bears when they showed up. And this is the example from one stream. This is just a cumulative number of photos that trail cameras caught on this stream over the course of the summer. We put them in early June. No bears show up until literally the day the salmon entered the stream. And then the camera rips off thousands of photos of bears until about the 15th of August. At that point, the fish are done spawning, they're all dead, and we see no more bears for the next month. And here the color maps onto the temperature of that stream. So now the question is, what happens at other streams? So now we lay over a few other streams. Again, the temperature corresponds here. And what we see is in all the cold streams is where we see all the bears initially. And then they're all gone from the cold streams by the middle of August. And the place on the landscape you see bears is now on all the warm streams, which are distinct places on the landscape. So what it appears is that bears are moving across the landscape, tracking this wave of salmon as it propagates across the landscape. We can't prove this based on this data because we'd like to say these are the individuals that move from cold sites to warm sites. We can infer that, although we have some colleagues who work on Kodiak, where they actually put satellite tags in bears, satellite collars, and they basically tested this hypothesis with satellite collar bears. Oh, actually, the gulls do this as well. Same deal. They're on the cold sites first, and they move down to the warm sites later. But this is Will Deasy published this last year, where again, he collared a bunch of female bears and asked, where do they go across the landscape? And sure enough, initially, they're at waterfalls on streams, where they can capture salmon on their way to the spawning grounds. Then they aggregate on streams, which are early spawning populations. Then they move into rivers, which are later spawning populations. And by October, all the bears are down on beaches. So again, on Kodiak, in this case, bears can feed on salmon starting in early July, and they can continue to feed on salmon into almost early November, as long as they can track this wave of salmon as it propagates across the landscape. Everyone talks about Kodiak brown bears and why they're so big. We think this is why Kodiak brown bears are so big. There's so much geomorphic complexity and hydrologic complexity that this foraging season is almost 4 or 5 months long, where something like Wood River, which I talked about earlier, is more about 2.5 to 3 months long. It turns out that we've done this for other species, the gulls. Turns out fish like Arctic grayling, rainbow trout are doing exactly the same thing. You put tags in these fish and they're actually following the salmon around on the landscape. And the salmon spawn at different times because of the geomorphic variation of individual tributaries. So what does that mean for conservation issues? These are all watersheds that are in pretty pristine condition, and things like mines are coming in, threatening the functioning of these watersheds. And the typical thing to do in a risk assessment is to say, all right, this watershed produces, let's say, 5 million salmon. Let's add up and figure out where the most productive sites are in the landscape and prioritize individual pieces of habitat based on how many fish they produce, okay? So that would be working under the assumption that the limiting resource is the number of salmon for the consumers, okay? Well, the alternative is to say, well, the number of salmon is not the key resource. It's the phenological variation that's the key resource, because it's the phenological variation that produces this extended opportunity for consumers. So what we're plotting here is the number of fish that are produced in individual populations versus the day of the year that they spawn. And the beaches, these are lakes, and the blue ones are the green ones are rivers. All the big populations are shown here. So it'd be really easy to go in and prioritize these sites for protection because they're the sites that represent the highest density of the resource. But if you then think about time as the limiting resource, you want to ask, well, what sites should we protect to maintain this long foraging season? And it's all these little streams. Streams that are, in some cases, only 2 or 3 meters wide. They're the ones that are cold. They're the ones that are often draining steeper watersheds. And these are the ones that are actually particularly valuable to consumers, not because they hold a lot of fish, but because they provide a unique opportunity early in the season for the consumers. So when you read the risk assessment of mines, for instance, they'll say, well, we need to dewater 10 or 15 streams, and we're going to lose some fish because of it, but it's only like 0.1% of the total fish production out of the watershed. We can assume this is insignificant. Well, it's not insignificant if you start thinking about what they provide as an opportunity in terms of foraging time to consumers. So what this means, at least in these watersheds, is protecting those little tiny pieces of habitat is probably really important. So what might this look like as we move into a warmer future? Alaska is going to continue warming, the precip regimes are going to change, and one of the big concerns, of course, is that snowpack is going to be lost. So those early sites are actually dependent on snowpack, and we just did some simple models to look at this. Again, this is work that Peter Lisi did, and what we have here is the water temperature sensitivity to changes in air temperature versus how much snow is in the stream. And just across 1 year, sites that have a lot of snow melt are not, their temperature is almost insensitive to changes in air temp, whereas sites that are mostly rainfall are very sensitive. So we actually use a slightly more complicated statistical approach to parse out the effects of snowpack and geomorphology together to figure out how is the thermal regime of these streams going to change as we move into the future. And it's a pretty interesting analysis that's starting to be fairly common in ecology. It's called dynamic factor analysis. And what it is essentially a principal components analysis, but it's done in a time series context. So really what you have is a bunch of variables, okay, that are occurring in this case, a region. And what you're asking is, are there trends in all of those variables that are shared amongst them, but for which we don't really have an explanation for them? There's some latent variable that they're sharing signal from. And then on top of that, we can estimate various covariates, such as snowfall or air temperature, that further modifies each of those streams. So this is an ugly figure, but it really shows the essence of what we have. This is 5 different years of data. These are the changes in air temperature for 5 different summers. And then we have something like 40 different streams that we're modeling through time. And this is what the trend looks like that's shared amongst all of those streams in any given year. Basically, and that is not explained by changes in air temperature. And in general, early in the season, it's negative, which means that the streams tend to be colder than you'd expect based on air temperature. It peaks right around the solstice, where streams tend to be warmer than average across the landscape. And then as the sun starts going away for the fall, things tend to be cooler again in the water, given the specified air temperature. And then what these show here is, here's our geomorphic gradient once again. And what these are is coefficients of individual streams on the air temperature gradient. So if it's down near zero, that individual stream does not track air temperature. And if it's strongly positive, it means that the stream temperature tracks air temperature. It's very sensitive to air temperature. Well, here's our geomorphic gradient again. Steep streams tend to be insensitive to temperature. Flat streams tend to be very sensitive to temperature. But what's interesting here is that if you look at what happens at really low steepnesses, some of these actually go negative. So that one goes negative, and that one goes negative. And it turns out that those are two summers following massive snowpacks. And what's happening there is that early in the summer, following a big winter snowpack, warm air temperature actually cools down streams. And the reason for that is warm air temperature melts more snow, you get more snow melt in the stream, and the temperature actually drops. Okay, so we can characterize this in a two-dimensional thing where we have our geomorphic gradient here, insensitive on steep streams, very sensitive on flat streams, and then this is further modified by snowpack. So the expectation here is as we move into a warmer future, particularly warmer winters, probably going to lose the snowpack. We're probably going to homogenize the thermal regimes across these landscapes because you're going to lose this buffering capacity of snow. So what does that mean for bears? Okay, so this is just the results of a very simple model where in this case, each line here is an individual population of fish, and this is the relative number of fish in the stream and vulnerable to predators. And this is what the distribution currently looks like across the watershed. Consumers can start accessing salmon around the middle of July, and they can sort of work their way down the cafeteria line and will be done eating salmon in streams about 50 or 60 days later. Okay, so the question is, what happens to this as we warm up the climate? So if we just warm up the climate and this is taken output from that last set of statistical models, we just warm up the climate and assume the snowpack is the same, this is what happens to the foraging season. So if you warm it up by 2 degrees and maintain the snow, if I'll just toggle back and forth here, nothing really changes. The assumption here is that the fish are tracking the spawn timings, adapting to the changes in temperature. But with snow, you anchor this early season foraging because the snowpack is always keeping those streams cold. And that you get a little shift later in the season as those streams warm up. But if we're gonna get warmer temperatures in this part of Alaska in the future, we're gonna lose snowpack. So then the question is, what happens to this? So now let's warm it up and start losing snowpack. And what you see here is that the right side of the distribution doesn't really change very much, but as you lose snow, the left side is moving later and later into the season. You get this compression of the foraging season available to the consumers. And if time is a limiting resource to them, you're taking away a lot of the opportunity. So that if you look at the end of the growing season and the start of the spawning, or sorry, end of the spawning season, beginning of the spawning season, under these various scenarios, you see this compression, and at least for foraging by bears, gulls, trout, and streams, what we see is that we're probably gonna go from a duration of foraging from about 2 months to less than a month, given, you know, modest amounts of climate warming and also loss of that winter snowpack. And these type of scenarios are really locked back onto the geomorphic conditions that we can extract from the landscape based on really basic GIS type approaches. So what I've just showed you is that whether it's carbon processing and carbon flow into consumers, whether it's the basic metabolic rates at which the ecosystem processes and remineralizes carbon, to what the opportunities are for foraging consumers that are integrating across the landscape, a lot of those processes can be locked in to individual places and modified by simple features of the landscape that we can get off of aerial photographs or GIS type approaches, DEMs. And with that, I'm happy to take some questions. Yep. We haven't done that, but that's a great question, and that's a great set of things for someone else to do in a different landscape where you're right, you're going to get confounding of, eutrophication of those streams at low gradients. We haven't done it, but I think the hypothesis would be pretty straightforward. If you ramp up the algal production in low gradient systems, you probably reduce their temperature sensitivity because the good stuff is going to be a bigger part of the budget. But we haven't done that. And we haven't really thought about it too much here because the main pressures on these landscapes is probably not eutrophication. It's probably things like roads and sort of infrastructure development and changes in climate, of course. But yeah, for developed landscapes, I think that's a great question. And yeah, eutrophication is going to confound these things. Yep.
First off, I'd like to say, as the head of the Watershed Sciences Department, you've made a brilliant case for the existence of our department.
Okay.
Saying that.
All right, thanks.
So most of the carbon is in the lowlands with low gradient.
Yep.
The water temperature is most sensitive to air temperature down there.
And yep.
The metabolic rates are most sensitive down there to increases in temperature.
Yep.
It sounds like in terms of carbon, in terms of CO2 being released to the atmosphere, it's kind of like a worst-case scenario.
Absolutely, yeah. So if you look at the landscape and ask which parts of those watersheds are going to change the most in the future, it's going to be the ones that have the most carbon in them.
Right.
Absolutely. Yeah. The flip side of that coin is if you say, well, what's warming going to do to the productivity of the food webs? I think the other answer is, well, those low gradient systems are also the ones that are probably going to increase in productivity the most as more of that organic matter is accessible to aquatic microbes.
Aquaculture.
Aquaculture, yeah. Right. There's a job waiting for you in Washington if you can spin it that way. Yeah. The best we can do is anecdotally from the last decade, we've had two of the highest snowfall years on record and two of the lowest snowfall years on record. And it seems to hold up in terms of, years with high snowpack, there's more that's going on with bear biology. They stick around in the dens longer and wait and wait and wait. It's when the snowpack goes out really early or there's thin snowpack, the bears are out early and they spend a lot more time ranging around trying to find something to eat. So there's more going on than what I've specified here. The problem is this part of Alaska, the snow data really suck. There just aren't any. They've put some snowtell sites in for the last 5 or 6 years, which is the data we're using with these statistical analyses. But in terms of hindcasting, there's a bunch of retrospective models that infer what snowpack might have been, but they're not really data to document it. There's data from airports that are way near the coast, and we could probably come up with some way to develop scenarios, but we haven't done that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so there's a, on the West Coast, there's a pretty vocal conservation movement which is out there to shut down commercial fisheries. And the reason they're out there to shut down commercial fisheries is their argument is that they're taking, in some cases, 80% of the fish, and as a result, they're basically starving terrestrial consumers because they're taking away 80% of their food. But that's working under the assumption that it's the abundance of the resource that matters to the consumers. What we've done with places where we have good data is ask, well, how sensitive is the abundance of the resource to the consumers? How sensitive is it to exploitation rate, depending on how much life history diversity you have? And basically what you see is it's very insensitive to exploitation rate as long as you maintain life history diversity in the system. At some point, the bottom falls out and you're just taking too many fish away. But over the range of exploitations that are occurring in Bristol Bay, it looks like the geomorphic conditions in the watershed actually buffer the sensitivity of the consumers to catching the fish in the ocean. But go ahead 100 years when we've lost all the snowpack, that's probably not going to be the case.